de Smurf.
Presence of death causes us to question the mystery of life. We find ourselves asking questions. Who am I? Where am I going? Where have I been? Someone has said that the only certainty of life is the uncertainty of it, and the Bible clearly confirms that truth. Job said, "My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and they come to an end without hope." And because of the uncertainty of life, we always need to consider its approaching end. That's why the psalmist wrote, "Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom." Paul, the apostle, wrote, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil." We're here for a lot of reasons today, but primarily to remember, to honor, and to say goodbye to Richard Brothers. It's a difficult day, but God provides comfort in our sorrow. The Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God." And we get this This word from God himself, written by Isaiah. God says to you today, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Even in our worst of days, God wants to remind us that he is holding us all up today in his right hand. And probably the most beloved passage of scripture of all time, one in which we find comfort today, the 23rd Psalm. It's in the program today. The psalmist wrote, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside wide waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray. Our Father, we turn to you today as the Lord of life, the giver of life, the sustainer of life. And in this moment of sorrow and brokenness, Lord, we seek you as our hope and our comfort. Someone we love is gone. And a void is in our hearts. But Father, we're just not quite sure how to fill these days. Lord, we're here today to honor, to remember Richard. We're here today to express our gratitude for his life. This family and friends are grateful for the blessings that he brought to their lives. So Father, help us in this time of loss and sadness and sorrow. Help us today to grasp hold of your promises, Lord, and find the comfort and assurance we need. Help us to elevate our own readiness for that day and that appointment that we will all keep. So in this moment and in this day and the days ahead, Lord, we just ask for your presence and blessing on us. We turn to you today for comfort and strength. Draw us closer to you and to each other. Help get us beyond the heartache of the present. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
I got sent home from school one day with a shiner on my eye. Fighting was against the rules and it didn't matter why. Dad got home and told that story just like I've heard. And stood there almost trembling knees and waited for the worst. He said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. He said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without an amen. It's a love without an amen. When I became a father in the spring of 81, there was no doubt that stubborn boy was just like my father's son. When I thought my patience had been tested to the end, I took my daddy's secret and I passed it on to him. I said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. I said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without an amen. It's a love without an amen. Last night I dreamed I died and stood outside those pearly gates. Suddenly I realize there must be some mistake. They don't have the things I've done, they'll never let me in. But then somewhere from the other side, I heard these words again. They said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. You see, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen.
Our father, Richard Brothers. He was more than just a man. He was a friend that could laugh when you needed it. A brother, an uncle, a husband, and most importantly of all, he was a great father and pal. Our dad is survived by his wife, Kimberly, a mom, his son, Chris, and his daughters, Frances, and myself, his two grandsons, Bradley and Alex, and also three brothers and two sisters. Our father was born December 2nd, 1949, and since then he has seen some amazing things, like the birth of his kids and grandkids, and some truly scary things, such as serving in the Army during the Vietnam War. But through all the good things and the bad things, he kept going until his body said, I'm tired, and he decided it was time to go see his parents again. He taught us many things, such as driving a car, riding a bike. He even taught me how to tie my shoes. Not sure how useful that is since I mostly wear flip-flops and boots now, but it's something I'll never forget. We will miss him so very much going forward in our lives. It will be hard not having him as a physical presence in our lives, but he will forever be in our hearts and minds. We love you, Daddy.
Love you.
Pablo Picasso, famous artist and sculptor, he lived a long life, but in his last years, he apparently preferred to ignore reality. During his last years of his life, he absolutely refused to permit anyone to mention the subject of death in his presence. He was so wary of the subject that he even refused to make out a will. That reluctance led to chaos and lawsuits among his several heirs when he did die. Unwilling to face reality, Picasso left behind misery for others. I'm pretty sure we all have been where Picasso was. We're not comfortable thinking about our own mortality. When told he didn't have much time left, the writer William Saroyan said, well, I knew that everyone died. I just thought in my case somehow an exception would be made. We know that's not true, and we can all identify with that. We don't look forward to a gathering such as this on our behalf. But still down deep, I know, and you know, no exceptions will be made. The reality of our mortality is always before us. And if we read the Bible, we keep coming across the very reminder of this appointment that we all have. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto humanity to die once. That's an appointment we'll all keep. We'll all keep that. And that's realism that realistic people must consider. Because the honest truth is we have very little choice in the matter. When we come to a memorial, a funeral service such as this, not only do we consider Richard's passing, husband, father, grandfather, friend, we probably think of our own approaching graduation from this life to the next. I'm going to be honest with you, the older I get, the more real this becomes. I'm just telling you, you know. The wisest man that ever lived, Solomon, wrote these words from Ecclesiastes 3. I like to call them the seasons of life. He wrote, there's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. I've always found that interesting because, you know, I deal with words all the time. And logically, and he was the wisest man that ever lived. And he wrote that, and when he talked about the seasons of life, he started with birth. That makes sense. But then he jumped right to, you know, there's a time to be born and a time to die. You know, like let's get that taken care of right away, because that's the reality. He says a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. Richard knew the seasons of life. And we're here today as he has completed that final season. Someone was asked one time, what is the meaning of life? And that may be what we're talking about today. It was asked several years ago to a number of prominent thinkers for an issue of Life magazine. That kind of tells you how long ago that was. But Martin Marty, a church historian at the University of Chicago, answered by saying, what is the meaning of life? The meaning of life is to love and to be loved. That is the meaning of life. Well, the Bible tells us, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Richard understood the meaning of life. He knew and practiced the importance of love through the concern and kindness that he offered others and through the goodness and kindness he received from others. He understood what it was to love and to be loved. He loved his family. He loved his country. And his family loved him. See, God made Richard a part of creation. He was a good man, a good father, grandfather, brother, and friend. He also understood the seasons of life. A time to laugh and a time to mourn. He has known sadness. He enjoyed times of laughing and speaking, but he also experienced times of weeping and keeping silent. He understood the season of war and the season of peace, to kill, to heal. He understood the seasons of life. He experienced most of those seasons that Solomon talked about. And we're here today, you're here today, because of your love for Richard. And we thank God for allowing Richard to share his life with you and you to share your life with him. The God who creates us and gives us earthly life isn't finished with us at the moment of our death. You see, God loves each one of us so much that he doesn't want our existence just to end because our heart stops beating or the death of our bodies. It's his intent, and has been from the very beginning, that he wants our lives to continue in his everlasting kingdom, a place where there's no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more crying, no more death. His goal, his passion, is to bring us all to a better place where we can be closer to him and to one another, free from anything that can ever hurt or divide us. We enter that perfect place through faith and belief in Jesus Christ. Jesus said these words, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." We gather here today to celebrate the life and the goodness of Richard Brothers, to give thanks for his love, his friendship, and his spirit. We gather here today to say goodbye and to remember. But at the same time, we celebrate the even greater goodness of God. We thank him for his love, seen so clearly in Jesus Christ, for his Holy Spirit, which gives us strength and hope today, for his people that surround us for comfort and support, and especially for his gift of forgiveness and the promise of everlasting life. The meaning of life is love, and God is love. And whoever loves knows God. That's what the Bible says. A meaning we can make our own as we remember Richard and as we all serve the Lord to the best of our abilities. Let's pray. God, we thank you today that the meaning of life is love. Father, we praise you for being at the heart of that great truth. And for giving all who love a chance to know you. Richard knew and practiced the importance of love. Father, you gave him the ability to live a life of love, to love his family, to love his country. So, Father, as we know that he knew the meaning of love, that he experienced all the seasons of life, grant us now your peace as we mourn his death. And Father, as grateful as we are for his goodness, Lord, we're more thankful for yours. You're the one who gives life meaning and purpose and offers each one of us the gift of everlasting life. So Father, I'm asking you today to comfort the hearts of this family and these friends who have gathered here as they say farewell to this good man. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Sunset, baby, I'd be satisfied.
But